welcome again to the 6th annual Center for Public Policy and Finance Conference. I hope everyone has a full schedule for today. We will start with a panel discussion. We have three panelists, and the topic of the panel is household surveys and income or wealth inequality in China. And we have three speakers. I'll introduce them briefly, and then we'll start. Mian, he is the Clifford Taylor Jr. Professor of Economics at Texas A&M University, and also a research associate at National Bureau of Economic Research. Then we have Terry Sicular. She is the Professor of Economics at University of Western Ontario, and before that she has taught at Stanford and Harvard. And our third speaker is Xiang Zhou. He is an assistant professor in the Department of Government at Harvard University, but prior to joining Harvard, he was a postdoc here at Princeton. So thank you all the speakers for coming here. We will go in the order that is listed on the schedule. So we'll start with Xiang Zhou from Harvard University. And it's 15 minutes each for the presentation, and then we'll open up for question and answers.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me. It's my great honor to be here. Today, I'm going to present some recent findings about income inequality and intergenerational social mobility in China, which comes mostly from my own research. In particular, I'm going to address four questions. The first is, how high is income inequality in today's China? And second is, what are the major determinants of inequality in China? And the third is, why has inequality increased in recent years? And the third and second questions are closely related, but they're conceptually distinct. And you will see later that the answers to these two questions could be quite different. And finally, I'll speculate a little bit about whether high inequality will necessarily lead to social and political instability from the perspective of distributive justice and equality of opportunity. So first, how high is income inequality in today's China? This appears to be a simple question that we could simply check by from the government statistics, but unfortunately, the official statistics, as you know, are not always reliable in China for many political and factual reasons. And in fact, the government rarely publishes the micro-level data that researchers could use to corroborate the macro-level figures that it releases to the public. And in the case of income inequality, the National Bureau of Statistics, the NBS, stopped releasing the Gini coefficient since the year 2000, when it first reached the level of 0.41, I think. So as a result, for a decade, for more than a decade, we didn't know much about income inequality, its level or trends in China. But at the end of 2012, there was a big media splash, thanks in part to Professor Gan Li sitting here, who declared that the Gini coefficient in China has now reached alarming level 0.61, which puts China among the most unequal countries in the world, alongside South Africa and some Latin American countries like Colombia and Brazil. And that finding was based on the China Household Finance Survey that Professor Gan himself directed at the Southwestern University of Finance and Economics. And data from that survey also indicates that average household income is actually higher than that reported by the National Bureau of Statistics, as you can see from the first panel in this chart. But the bad news is that the distribution of household income is highly skewed. As you can see from the middle panel, if we compare China and the US, the share of the total household income earned by the top 20% is much higher in China than in the US. So as a result of highly skewed income distribution, we observe the extreme inequality as shown in the Gini coefficient. But only a month later, the National Bureau of Statistics responded in January 2013. You can see from this chart, income inequality, according to NBS, did not increase at all. Actually, it declined a little bit since the year 2008. So overall, it hovered around the level 0.47, 0.48, which is much lower than the 0.61 estimate from China Household Finance Survey. So such a large gap prompted us to ask the question, who's correct? Who has the accurate estimate of Gini coefficient? And to answer that question, we calculated our own estimate of Gini coefficient from 7 newly available and nationally representative survey data sets. And one of them is a large-scale mini-census, inter-census survey administered by the NBS, which is the mini-census 2005. But the other 6 are all from independent and university-affiliated survey organizations. They are specifically Chinese General Social Survey in 2010-2012, the China Family Panel Studies in 2010-2012, and the China Household Finance Survey in 2011, as well as the China Labor Force Dynamics Survey in 2012. And for each of these 7 surveys, we calculate the Gini coefficient among families who reported a positive household income in the previous calendar year. And our results are summarized in this chart. Here you can see the black dots are earlier estimates of Gini coefficient assembled by the United Nations University World Institute for Economic Development Economic Research. And the red squares are estimates we calculated from these new data sets. And the red line is a non-parametric curve that would fit it to all those points, which shows trends in Gini coefficient in China since late 1960s. And from this trend, you can see income inequality has grown dramatically since around the year of 1980 when the economic reform started. And according to the smooth estimate, the Gini coefficient in 2012 was about 0.55. which is much higher than the official figures published by NBS. But on the other hand, it's much lower than the 0.61 estimate from the China Household Finance Survey. So our smooth estimates lie somewhere in between. And this chart puts China in a comparative perspective, in which I compare China with the other 4 large emerging economies, namely India, Brazil, Russia, and South Africa. And you can see from the so-called BRICS countries, China has experienced the most dramatic growth in income inequality over the past 3 decades. So as a result, now China is more unequal than India, Brazil, and Russia, and very close to South Africa, which is the most unequal country in the world. Now let's put the abstract Gini coefficient aside for a while and look at the concrete income distributions. So this chart shows, the bar plot shows the family income at different quantiles from the 5%, 10%, all the way through 95% in 2005 and 2012, which I calculated from the mini census 2005 and the Chinese General Social Survey in 2012. And the black line shows the growth of family income at different quantiles. And we can see for almost all quantiles, income has grown a lot. For instance, the median income, according to 2 surveys, almost tripled over the 7 years. But from the black line, you can also see income growth is highly uneven. It was much slower than at the lower end than for other quantiles. So it implies that the increase in inequality over this period is largely driven by the poor lagging behind, rather than the rich leaping ahead, right? So to answer the first question, we can say that China's income inequality since 2005 has reached very high levels with the Gini coefficient in the range of 0.53 to 0.55. Now let's move on to the second question. What are the main determinants of inequality in China? To answer this question, in the same paper, we compare China with the United States. In the so-called partial R-square, which is a measure of the percentage of variance explained for a particular variable after we control for everything else. So for these 5 variables, we can see for both China and the US, the most significant determinant of inequality is education. But apart from that, inequality in China is much more mediated by region and area type, namely the rural-urban divide. On the other hand, inequality in the US is more mediated by race, ethnicity, and family structure. So from this chart, we tentatively conclude that a substantial part of China's high inequality is still due to large regional disparities, as well as a deep rich rural-urban gap. Now let's move on to the third question. Why has inequality increased so much in recent years? And from previous discussion, you might imagine that the increase in inequality is a result of widening rural-urban gaps as well as a growth in regional inequality. But that is not necessarily the case, because earlier research has indicated that back in the early 1980s, when the economic reform just started, China is already characterized by large rural-urban gaps and large regional disparities. So the increase over the past several decades is not necessarily due to these two factors. And the prominent explanation in the economics literature is the so-called skill-biased technological change, which persists that the change in technology has increasingly favored skilled workers over non-skilled workers. And this explanation played a large part in explaining the rise of inequality in the United States, especially in the 80s and 90s. And it has two implications. First, because education is a good proxy of skill, so we might predict the rise of inequality is partly driven by an increase in returns to education. But some skills are not necessarily captured by education or other observed determinants. For instance, coding skills or social skills. So we might also predict a large increase in the residual inequality, the residual variance in a regression equation that accounts for some other manifest predictors. But in recent work, I also hypothesized that the rise in inequality in China could also be driven by some compositional changes, especially changes in labor force structure. First, the expansion of higher education, especially since the late 1990s, has generated a more dispersed education distribution. So even if returns to education maintain constant, a more dispersed education distribution could result in a higher level of total inequality, right? Mainly due to the composition effect. And also the SOE reform, as well as the large expansion of the private sector, has also generated a large decline in the share of state sector employment and a consequent increase in the share of private sector employment. And to the extent that income distribution is more compressed, more concentrated in the state sector than in the private sector, even after we control for everything else, then this compositional change in the relative proportions of state sector over private sector employment could also generate an increase in overall total inequality. So in a recent paper, I tested these competing explanations for the rise of inequality among urban workers from the year 2000, from the year 1996 to 2010. And from this chart, you can see a large increase in earnings inequality among urban workers during this period, measured either by the Gini coefficient or the variance of log earnings. And this chart summarizes my results. And you can see almost half of the total rise in inequality, about 45% of the rise in inequality, can be attributed to increasing returns to education during this period. But on the other hand, changing sectoral composition and the changing educational composition each accounts for about 20%. And by contrast, widening regional disparities or residual inequality played a very minimum role in explaining rise in inequality over these 15 years. So finally, let's move on to the last question. So the third conclusion is that the rise in urban inequality, at least during the past two decades, are mainly driven by increasing returns to education and changing labor force structure. So finally, let's move on to the last question. Will high inequality necessarily lead to social and political unrest? So to consider this question, let's consider what have been the major sources of the legitimacy of the Chinese Communist Party since the founding of the People's Republic. First, before the economic reform, in the Maoist period, we can say that the legitimacy of the regime is largely egalitarianism. In that period, the party, the economic policy followed largely a Marxist ideology. So in that period, everyone was eating from the same big pot, and there wasn't much unfairness or inequity to complain about in the first place. But since the economic reform started, income inequality has soared, as we just seen. And the conventional wisdom is that during this period, the regime has derived the legitimacy more and more from strong economic performance, and some scholars have talked about performance legitimacy. But now, as the economy is cooling down, and inequality is likely to maintain high, what would be the next source of legitimacy? And in my view, a candidate that is worth considering is meritocracy. By meritocracy, I mean equality of opportunity rather than equality of outcomes, right? So to measure equality of opportunity, we could have two things. First is we could try to see what people see, how people see about rising inequality. What are the perceived attitudes toward rising inequality among ordinary Chinese people? And we could also observe actual degrees of intergenerational social mobility, whether it has increased or decreased over recent years. So first, let's look at perceived attitudes. First, this is a chart showing results from a 2010 national survey conducted by Martin White at Harvard. So in that survey, people were asked about why some people in China are poor and why some people in China are rich. So you can see the top three explanations for why people in China are poor are lack of ability, lack of effort, and low education. For instance, over 60% of Chinese people think that lack of ability plays a very large influence in explaining why some people in China are poor. And by contrast, only 20% of the Chinese people think that unfair economic system plays a large or very large role. Similarly, if we look at why people in China are rich, the top three explanations are ability and talent, hard work, and high education. So now let's look at the actual degree of intergenerational social mobility. I'll skip this slide due to some time constraint. And basically, we have good reasons to believe that intergenerational social mobility has declined over recent years during the market transition from state socialism to a relatively market economy. So this is a so-called golden triangle in social stratification research. Basically, your destination socioeconomic status depends on your origin, both directly and also through education. And the link from origin to education may have strengthened due to the abolition of egalitarian educational policies that was once popular in the Maoist period. And the link from education to destination could have also increased due to labor market liberalization, increasing returns to education. And the link, direct link from origin to destination could have also strengthened due to the conversion of political power into economic wealth, which could be directly inherited from the father's generation to the son's generation. So overall, we might expect an increase in the association between parents and children in their socioeconomic status. And this is confirmed by our data. So this shows that the so-called strength of status hierarchy has strengthened, which is basically a measure of the intergenerational association between father's occupational status and the son's occupational status. You can see from the cohort born in the 1950s to the cohort born in the 1970s, status hierarchy has significantly strengthened. But on the other hand, if we compare China with the advanced industrial countries in Western Europe and North America, such as England, France, the United States, China is still a much more fluid country than those countries. In other words, intergenerational social mobility is still quite high in China, at least compared with those advanced industrial countries, at least for the cohort born in the 1970s. So now let's move on to the last conclusion. That is, today's high inequality in China is unlikely to cause social unrest. First, because ordinary Chinese people still hide indoors merit-based inequality, and they still believe that inequality in China is due to their hard work and innate ability. And also, actually, the intergenerational social mobility is still quite high compared with mature capitalist countries in Western Europe and North America. Thank you very much.
Next speaker is Li Gan.
Hi, Professor Zhou has made a good introduction. He mentioned my data set, and he mentioned that I'm way out there in terms of Gini coefficient. I find this being a while. So I think the first time I released the Gini coefficient is December of 2012. And then we forced the NPA, National Bureau of Statistics, to come out their own Gini coefficient for 10 years afterwards. Since then, I have been defending my data for about a year or so, 2 years. I thought I no longer need to defend it, and I figure out I need to defend it again. So I'm going to spend a little bit of effort to defend the data set, kind of to tell what's going on here, and to compare my data with what we found from NBS data, and then move from there. Okay, so brief introduction of the Chinese Household Finance Survey. Dr. Zhou used the first wave. The first wave is here, it's 2011. We have 8,400 households. So since then, we have done another two waves. 2013, we went to the field. We went back to the original 8,000 households. And then we expanded another 20,000. So 2015, we expanded again. So we went back to the 28,000 household to interview them again. So we have a panel. So we can do the data panel. And then we expand the data set again to 40,000 households. So I believe this is the largest non-governmental survey that we can find in the world. So how we did the sampling? We basically ranked the per capita GDP based on per capita GDP at the county level by each province. So we randomly select 14% on average of counties of each province, 14%. So there's 363 cities, districts, or counties. So for each county, we went back, we ran from the NBS website, there is a community, the list of the community. There are 1,700,000 communities in China. And the name of the community, the code of the community, everything is widely available over the years. Each year, you can find it. So for those communities, we randomly select four of them outside for each county. So then we have about 1,400 communities nationwide. There's no more data available in China. There's no postal address, telephone record, etc. So we went to each of the community. We carefully mapped each apartment, each house, at for the all of the communities. So we have our own software to do that. We call that mapping or listing, whatever you call. Then we label each of the house, then randomly select between 20 and 50 of them, depends on the housing price, because we want to oversample a little bit of the rich households. Obviously, there's vacant houses, so we have other study is quite influential in China about vacant house vacancy rate. Then we go there, so we select this household. We send thousands of the students to each of those households. We have the support of the central bank, so the local branches of the central bank are mobilized to take our interviewers to the neighborhood community, tell the commissioners or local community officials, say, you know, these are the government supported project. They are not trying to sell you anything. They're not trying to cheat you or whatever. So local community people take my interviewer to knock off the doors we randomly selected. And to then basically to verify, to tell them that, trust them. So that earns the initial trust. Obviously, I'm asking some of the most sensitive information of the household. They're not gonna talk to you, most likely the first round. So my students are persistent and they insist. So they have to go back six times before they give up one sample. So that's how difficult. So most difficult neighborhood I want to mention that is Shenzhen. We have 12 people in that neighborhood for 50 households. We spent 47 days in order to convince them to talk to us. So this is an extraordinary effort by thousands of the students. So this is just one brand, one part. We like to, China, in China, go to China to conference or anything like that, we like to take group photo. Plus we do the group photo, there's one brand. There's three bunch of them. So now, in 2015, there's probably two or three bunches in 2013. And we're doing that again this summer. And this summer, we're gonna have a very different mechanism. We'll have six universities join me nationwide to do that. So we probably will have much larger, even larger sample than 2015. So that's how this, just to give you an example about the quality of the data. So this is, we have done lots of verifications about quality of data. We know the panel, so we can estimate correlations of the income over those panels, and we find they have the correlation is as high as any panel data set you can find in the United States. Another way we want to say that is, this is one thing we can say, we claim we have a provincial representation. So it's not only nationwide, each province is representative. Each of the big cities are representative. How we do that? So this example is, this is a study we've been working on about, in China there's a housing provident fund. So typically each employee is set aside between 5 to 12% of your salary aside. Your company match 5 to 12% of your salary as a housing fund to support you buying houses. That's been running for 20 years in China. There's almost zero study about that in China. It just is amazingly market failure, I would say. So what we've done is we just compare, because government statistics is not going to lie on how many people are covered in this data set, right? They're not going to lie for that. It's accurate. So this is my data set. My data set is 17% of the population are covered. Government data set is 16.4% of the data are covered. And this is the rest of the province. There's some difference, like this one, Zhejiang, there's some difference. But almost all provinces, except a few, we have almost very close coverage rate between between the government statistics and my data set. So that's one thing. I'll talk about the income later, okay? So inequality. So my argument actually, I support Dr. Zhou's argument that 0.61 whatever is not going to cause any unrest. It is actually the key reason why China has insufficient consumption. But I'm going there. So this is a Gini coefficient. So they mentioned the first one. And so we have 2012. So 2013 survey of 2012 data income and 2015 survey of 2014 data. The panel will give me almost identical, a little bit, a 0.1% difference in terms of Gini coefficient. All right, this is urban and rural. So what we find, for another data set, we're trying to understand, you know, what's the recent trend of the change of inequality. We don't find much of the trend inequality at aggregate level. However, we do find rural has increasing inequality and urban has decreasing inequality over those several years since 2010, basically. That would be the information. NBS, as I said, NBS has released the data set in January. It is because of because I've released the data has caused some, you know, debates. So I'm going to. This is one of my attempts to compare my data with NBS data to see why we have such a difference in terms of Gini coefficient. So this is a percentile. In my data set, in urban China, if you make 280,000 in your household, 280,000, you are in more than 280,000, you are in top 1% of China, urban China. I don't think this is a number outrageous. If you know China, you make up. What NBS data will say is 100,000. That's the difference. So at the top, we're almost three times as high as NBS data. So the question is, you know, obviously why? We have a refusal rate of 12%, 11-12%, almost all cohort, getting down a little bit. Urban is 6%, 15%, 14% of each of the way of the exact refusal of the rate. You know, no matter how much effort you have made, there's still somebody refuse to talk to, and those people are not random, obviously. They're richer, they have their time is more costly, right? The time opportunity cost is more is higher. So, but this is how the difference comes from. And there's many other comparisons, and there's many, you know, aggregate data, my data, all kinds of comparisons. We've done lots of study trying to show, you know, we don't have time, but I can talk this forever. But this is what I think, I think that how this whole organization. So I'm very happy to see that we have a session about data. I think that the issue right now is not yet about to understand, obviously it's important to understand why Chinese income inequality is as high as it is. So I talk about, you know, what's the consequence of that? We'll talk about it. But I think the even more important information about China in general, that's my point, is we don't understand the baseline. We don't even know income. We have almost no information before my survey about assets, household assets. We know nothing about household assets, right? And so that's why there's quite many surveys now in China start to emerge. I mentioned that there are six universities will join me. Each university will have its own survey, labeled, you know, their own surveys. They have, you know, like. They join me, we do a big survey, but each university has own label and own brand in terms of survey. Universities have seen a tremendous benefits of university in terms of the raising reputation, academic reputation, and also awareness, and also policy research, etc. So anyway, that's all right. How to understand? What happens if we exclude the poorest 1% or 5%, Gini coefficient has very little change. If we exclude the richest 5% or even richest 1%, the Gini coefficient is down from 0.61 to 0.52. So it's very, very clear that the difference between my data set and an other data set or an NBS data is that whether you are able to get into the household, the rich household, and you're able to convince them to talk to you, to give you something, and that's the key. There's nothing else. I think that's why I'm very open in terms of how each of neighborhood you can go find out how much refusal rate in my data set. Obviously, richer neighborhood you're gonna have higher rate of refusing to talk to you. Like we have some neighborhood has as high as 30%. Some neighborhood obviously, for example, rural China. The problem is not refuse to talk to you, it's they don't let you go. keep talking to you. That's the problem. It's a very different problem. All right. So we try something. So we exclude household in monopoly industries. They have household member working in monopoly industries. We exclude household working in public sector. There's very little change in Gini coefficient. Those are not the reasons causing the very high Gini coefficient. And there's another thing we want to mention, the income transfers. The income transfer program and taxes are not effective reducing the Gini. If no income transfer programs at all, just nothing. We because we know how much they are transferred, we take out of those. Obviously, these are partial analysis. We don't talk about general equilibrium effect. So we took out that, then little change. Then if no social security income, that makes quite a bit of difference, then the Gini coefficient is 0.68. So it's much higher, substantial change. If no income tax, there's little change. So income tax now has produced very, very little change of the Gini coefficient because we only tax basically salary income. We are not able to tax capital gains tax. And also, there's only 2% of population pay income taxes. It's only less than 5% of the government revenue coming from income tax. That's the Chinese fact. So that's why, so we'll come back to the issues. So this is the OECD countries' Gini coefficient before transfer and before income tax. This is based on their market income. So your salary is 200,000, 150. We use that number to measure the Gini coefficient in the United States and other countries. It's basically is a 0.5 range, right? 0.4, 0.5 range. And I just told you that Chinese transfers and taxes make no difference in terms of the income, how much, oh, yo. In terms of, okay, all right, thanks. All right, Chinese transfer tax made no difference in terms of the Gini coefficient. So if you think that way, anybody who go to China will understand that China's heterogeneity, the regional difference, the rural-urban difference, you know, mountain area, mountainous area versus, versus the rest of the area, the huge difference compared with any of the developed countries. If you view the Gini coefficient is lower than 0.5, it's inconceivable. It's inconceivable. It is supposed to be. The transfers and the taxes did not make difference, right? So that's the number. So what's the problem? I'm going to mention quickly. So I think this is we want to mention that this is a saving. It is a problem of the saving. So it's a very simple story. For example, you look at the obviously poor, you're gonna have lower saving rate. Rich, you have higher saving rate, but you compare people, the saving in terms of the inequality, the rich saving higher percentage of income, and with credit constraint, those with credit constraint, this is a credit constraint. Oh, this is not credit constraint, this is credit constraint. So those people with credit constraint and those people with higher income have higher saving rate. Yeah, exactly, yeah. So give me some either, this is a, so 30% of the Chinese saving rate, household saving rate, is not everybody saves 30%, obviously. There's only two-thirds of the household save. The rest of one-third actually did not save, they don't have, they make ends meet, though they actually have a negative income. They have a negative saving for that year. And this is the saving rate for the highest 5%, the saving rate in China is 71%. They save 71% of the income. The proportion of the total saving for that year is 52%. And the US saving rate relatively to the top 5% is 37%. So highest 20%, the same 80% of the income, of the total saving, okay. So China's problem is the rich saves too much. So you stimulate consumption, it's not gonna make much of a difference. Because stimulate consumption, you stimulate those, the poor, they already or they want to consume, they have incentive to consume, they don't have the money to consume. It's very, very simple. So we have other more substantial study to show this. All right, so we tried, I think the minimum income, minimum wage does not make much of a difference. And this is OECD country after transfer. It's 0.3%, from 0.5 to 0.3, okay? I'm going to finish in a few minutes, okay? 2 minutes. So China actually spent very little in transferring income transfers. So we counted every possible income transfers from the official statistics. China is about 12% of the spending. And I know some of the transfer actually increased urban-rural. We know that increased urban-rural difference. We transfer a lot more to the urban than to the rural. And so you, if you count the Social Security, it's 21%. You don't, and the US is 46% versus 36% in terms of that. And US is not, you know, relatively speaking, is not a high social welfare country. And US Congressional Budget Office, the poorest 20% household market income, 75% after transfer, this including Social Security, is 30,000. That's the, and we show that this is a person, we send their money there. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm good. And we show that if you do that, if you spend about US percentage in terms of transfer, the Gini coefficient will be down to 0.42, similar level. How we do that? So what we've tried is, we believe this is what China should be doing, and we believe this is China should be going. So we say, okay, how to do the income transfers? Obviously, don't want to have a generation or have so many people welfare dependent. And we try to borrow international experience. And EITC is working in the United States, and also some type of conditional transfer program. So first, you know, the conditional transfer program is an incentive compatible program. China has nothing there. There's only one program called free lunch. Free lunch for school kids, for poor school kids. Three RMB per kid per day. That already has tremendous effect on increasing the school enrollment. It's a wonderful program. It supports about 20 million kids. It's a wonderful program, but that's it. There's nothing else. There's nothing else in China going on for this type of transfer program. And there's the earned income tax program in your 1 minute, okay, is a 30% for the US. 30% for US, negative 30%. All right, so what we've done is, this one. What we've done is, we believe this is the right way to do, and the government asked me, say, okay, if we believe you, how we do it? Okay, so what we've tried is, we basically started field experiments in China, ourselves, about 120 households. This is a pilot in the, you know, as a treatment, 120 people as a control, about 120. This is our, this is how we do it. If their labor income, this is per capita income, going this way, we're basically up to 1,000 per month. So we go and verify each of the household income, and we give the money each month. We've been doing this for how many years? Now it's almost, 3 years. It's almost 3 years. And this is, it's been wonderful. It's been wonderful. So we're expanding this program, and obviously needs funding. I'm trying to talk to government officials to raise funding to this. It's been wonderful. There's some variations about which month, how much of a change over time, but they have increased the clothing, food, and the living expenses, and also other expenses for. They increased the labor, the employment rate by 10 percentage point. They increased the working hours by 27 hours, and also increased the labor income by 372 RMB per month, and also increased the consumption as well. So basically, this program has been running there, and lots of people have reported this program. Many people talk to me. We have videos, we show, we have stories, we have manual how to do this, etc. We have software to do this as well. So I think it's an attempt to trying to convince government. You cannot just talk about it. You need to tell them how to do it. Here is the manual how to do it. I think it's getting traction in China. So I'm going to stop here because I'm running out of my time. But anyway, thank you.
Our next speaker is Terry Sicular.
Yeah. I think we should rename this panel Dueling Surveys. I'm going to talk about yet another household survey. I would say the more information, the better. There's no such thing as a perfect household survey. They each have strengths and weaknesses, and the details matter, which is why I appreciate some of the discussion from the prior panelists. And today I'm going to talk about a survey that's been going on for a long time, run by the China Household Income Project, or CHIP. It has strengths and weaknesses. I hope I'll convince you it has enough strengths to be pay attention to. So let's get started. This is a conference about escalating risks in China, and as previous panelists have mentioned, one area of concern of potential risk is associated with high and rising inequality in China, for reasons already discussed. In China, inequality was low at the sort of end of the Maoist era, and with the market reforms, economic reforms, inequality began to rise. Past studies have shown that rise was progressive and continual, and by the early 2000s reached a fairly high level. In the early 2000s, concerns about rising inequality led or prompted the government to take quite a sort of strong set of measures, a broad set of measures to provide a broader social safety net and to enhance and benefit incomes in the lower and middle ranges of the income distribution to try to counteract the trend towards increasingly high levels of inequality. And those efforts have continued through to the present. Official estimates by the National Bureau of Statistics, or NBS, which have been referred to in earlier by my previous panelists, indicate that inequality reached a peak around 2008, and then since then has leveled off and even declined. I'm going to ask, using this alternative or this other data set, I'm going to investigate the recent trends in inequality in China and ask some of the same questions that my co-panelists have asked, but using different information. In fact, how high is inequality in China? How much has it, if it has declined, how much has it declined in recent years? I'll present some estimates based on the CHIP data, which will allow us, which is household level data, so we can check recent trends in inequality and see how robust they are. I'll also look a little bit at the shape of inequality, the patterns of inequality that underlie recent trends in inequality. And these estimates are based on joint work with other members of the CHIP team, especially Li Shi, Luo Qiliang, Yue Ximing, and Hiroshi Sato. So as you know from the previous talks, details matter with data and measurement. Let me tell you a little bit about the data set that we work with. This was a survey research project that began in the late 1980s. The point was to collect household level data, which was not available at the time, with a specific goal of being able to measure incomes and inequality and track changes in incomes and inequality over time. I'm going to talk about results based on the most recent two surveys from 2007 and 2013. It's a large national sample. It's a subset. We work in cooperation with the National Bureau of Statistics. We pay the National Bureau of Statistics to work with us on this survey. The the National Bureau of Statistics, which produces the official Gini estimates, is a large, carries out annual household surveys that are very large, and we receive a subset of that data at the household level. But in addition, we have an independent questionnaire that collects additional supplementary information. So the CHIP data set has information from two sources. Some of the information, a lot of the income information, both total income and components of income, come to us from the National Bureau of Statistics. And some of the information comes from this independent questionnaire. Now, to measure income, to measure inequality, you need good income data, household level income data. And the NBS, the core of the income data in the CHIP sample is, in fact, income data collected by the National Bureau of Statistics. Now, people question official data in China. There's a lot of different kinds of official data, and it's really not fair to paint it all with one brush. In the household survey work done by the National Bureau of Statistics, it's staffed by a professional, well-trained statistician. The data are collected through stratified random sampling. They use a diary method to collect income information, which means that households are recording their incoming income and expenses in a real-time basis. They're not being asked at the end of the year, how much income did you have, through a recall method. And while there are disadvantages to a diary method, it's time-consuming and expensive, nevertheless, it captures a lot of different kinds of information about income that you can't capture through by asking people at the end of the year how much income they made. And it's especially important for households that have a variety of different sources of income from their own businesses, from farming, from raising chickens or pigs, from casual labor, and so forth. So the MBS takes the information it collects in the diary and it constructs a measure of income using a certain income definition. And these income estimates have a lot of positives. They're good income data if you understand what they do and don't capture. They have some flaws. So what we try to do, the China Household Income Project has tried to do, is take the data from the MBS that's given to us by the MBS and take the additional data that we have collected through our independent survey and investigate and correct and adjust the measures of income and inequality and see how robust the results are. So here I'm going to list some of the key adjustments we try to make. One is we've come up with an adjusted measure of income that's consistent over time. The National Bureau of Statistics has changed its definition of income. There was a big change in 2013. So MBS income data from before 2013 and since 2013 is not completely comparable. So we can ask the question, if you make income consistent before and after this definitional change, do we still see a decline in inequality in China? Also, the MBS income measure does not follow standard international practice for income measurement. We've adjusted it to be more in line with standard international income definitions. And we can ask again, when we make that adjustment, do we see similar levels and trends in inequality as published in the official data? There's some additional measurement issues. One has to do with prices. In most parts of the world, most countries, prices are higher in places where richer people tend to live, and prices are lower where poorer people tend to live. Consequently, a dollar can buy less in a rich neighborhood or a rich region than it can in a poor region. And that means that part of measured inequality is measuring price differences. It isn't part of it measures differences in prices. Not all of measured inequality is reflecting real differences in purchasing power, the purchasing power of incomes in different regions and among different households. So we have used available information, imperfect information, but available information on spatial prices to make an adjustment in income so we can compare and see how much of a difference it makes if we control for these spatial price differences.
Another
issue, and this relates to some of the issues raised by Li Gan, is underrepresentation of income at the top of the income distribution. Rich households and their incomes are difficult to capture in household surveys. This is a general problem with household surveys, not just for China. And consequently, household surveys tend to lead to understatement of inequality. So we use the CHIP data and we use some other sources of data to estimate the top tail of the income distribution and incorporate that into an adjusted estimate of inequality and see how much of a difference that makes when we try to correct for the understatement of the top tail of the income distribution. The measure of the inequality, the estimates I'm going to show you use what's called the Gini coefficient. Many of you know what that is, but just so everyone's on board, it ranges from zero for perfect equality to one for perfect inequality. Obviously, no country has perfect inequality or equality. Most countries lie somewhere in between, and here's a picture of a range of countries. Low inequality countries tend to have Gini's of about 0.25, 0.26. High inequality is over 0.6. And in 2007, China's Gini coefficient, as by our estimate, was inching towards 0.5, inching towards the level seen in Brazil, which is not considered a low inequality country. So now let me show you some of the estimates. So first, here on this table, you see estimates of inequality using the MBS income definition with no changes. In the top row, adjustments to make inequality, the income measure consistent between 2000 and 2013. In the second row, that's what we call adjusted MBS income. And then additional, adding in some components of income that are not included in the MBS income definition. That's CHIP income in the bottom row. And you can see these adjustments change somewhat the level of inequality, but in all three cases, the measure of inequality did, in fact, decline from 2007 to 2013. And in fact, the adjustments increase the extent of the decline in inequality. So this is positive news if it's correct. Inequality perhaps has turned the corner. And China consequently has moved down in the lineup of countries in terms of inequality. What underlies this decline? In the CHIP data, we see a doubling of incomes in the six-year period for households in the bottom half of the income distribution. So here's a graph showing changes in income for the bottom 10%, the second bottom to the bottom 10%, and so forth, all the way to the top 10% of the income distribution. Income growth was much more rapid for households and individuals in the bottom half of the income distribution than in the top. Although the top also experienced substantial increases in income of 40%. Interestingly, inequality, it declined not just for total income, but also for most different sources of income, including wage earnings became more equally distributed, business earnings became more equally distributed, pension income, asset income, and so forth. The one source of income that became less equally distributed was agricultural income, but it remained a very equally distributed form of income. The urban-rural gap has historically been associated with and considered one of the factors driving up inequality in China. And you can see here that over time, the urban-rural income gap increased to the point where in 2007, it was about urban incomes were about four times on average rural incomes. The CHIP data for 2013 shows a decline, a substantial decline in the rural-urban income gap to back to where it was in the 1980s, really. I don't have time to evaluate or discuss why that occurs, but the simple answer is that rural incomes grew very rapidly during these 6 years. And finally, regional income gaps also narrowed. This graph shows the ratio of eastern incomes to central incomes on the left-hand side. The blue bars are 2007, the green bars are 2013. You can see that, for example, in the ratio of eastern to central incomes fell from 1.83 to 1.52. And the ratio of the center, averaging from central China to western China, declined from 1.2 to 1.05. So in 2013, in fact, incomes on average in western China were pretty close to incomes in central China. The West was catching up with the East. Is the decline, if we adjust for differences in spatial prices, do we still see a decline in inequality? The yellow rows here are adjusted for these spatial price differences. Adjusting for spatial prices reduces inequality, which is good, I suppose, but it reduces the decline in inequality. The inequality still declines, but by not as much, because prices between rich and poor areas have come closer. Is the decline robust to incorporating top incomes? There are methodologies developed for estimating the top tail of the income distribution. I can talk more about how we do that later. It requires fairly strong assumptions, but we have carried out these sorts of calculations, estimated the top tail of the income distribution, and combined those estimates with the information we have from the CHIP survey to come up with an estimate of inequality for all of China. And we've used different assumptions to get a low, medium, and high estimate. And here in this table, you can see the results of those estimates. Incorporating the top tail of the income distribution in 2007 raises inequality, but not a huge amount, by maybe 8 to 10%. In 2013, however, these adjustments make a big difference in the level of inequality, raising it. The range of estimates is from about 0.49 to as high as 0.63, depending on the estimates. And consequently, when we incorporate top incomes, inequality no longer declines, even by our low estimates. And in some cases, it increases substantially. So let me make a few concluding remarks. I want to reiterate that the details, or at least some of the details, do matter for understanding and accurately measuring inequality. Price adjustments matter, and accurately capturing the top of the income distribution, we do it one way, other researchers do it other ways, it matters too. Was the decline in inequality in the official statistics real? Being an economist, I'd say yes and no. On the one hand, on the other hand, it is real for the part of this of the income distribution that's captured in surveys. I'm quite confident that the changes for the bulk of the population are captured well in the sort of survey data that we use, even though some of the decline reflects price changes rather than real changes in inequality. But it isn't real if you are thinking about the entire population. If the survey sample did capture the top income, the top tier of the income distribution, the decline, in my view, would likely disappear. I've talked about some of the factors that underlie the decline. More research is needed in this regard. And I'll just end by telling you to stay tuned for the next CHIP inequality book. We're working on it, and I hope it'll come out in the next year or so. Thank you.
I'll request all the three panelists please come. So we'll have an open question answer session.
Let me I thank all the panelists for a very interesting presentation. I have two comments. One is, I want to argue that all three papers are emphasizing a wrong variable. I mean, from social justice point of view, we care about two things. One is equality of opportunity rather than equality of realized income. And two is we care about whether the people at the bottom have see improvement in living standard or not. And the last one, all the surveys we'll look at clearly shows that people at the bottom in the country have seen improving living standards. That's not controversial. What about equality of opportunities or mobilities, right? So one thing people will look at it will be today's generation's income relative to their parents or grandparents' income, since people in the 1970s, 80s had very low inequalities. Mechanically, it's quite plausible the greater the dispersion of today's income, the lower will be the correlation of one's today's income relative to their parents' and grandparents' income. So in other words, income inequality could go exactly the opposite direction, potentially, from equality of mobility in a mechanical sense. But going forward, of course, we want to know whether what has happened to that dependence ratio. And you know, at least the Gan Li survey has an opportunity to examine that. And I want to hear you if you have done anything on this, or encourage you to go in that direction. The second thing is about the price adjustment Terry mentioned, which is very interesting and important. I want to argue that, in fact, the regional adjustment may not be enough. Price index can also vary by income group. In particular, for higher income group, the regional variation in price level becomes less important. The top 10%, top 5% of the households probably shop internationally. And people often say that for branded products, Chinese prices are higher than US prices. And high income households also increasingly travel internationally. So the right price adjustment may well be higher for higher income households. So it's not linear, it's not automatically, monotonically the varies with income. In any case, there's an interaction between regional adjustment and income adjustment.
Other question? We'll just take maybe three questions and then have a collective response.
Thank you. These are three really wonderful presentations on such a central issue. Just a couple of comments, and particularly in the first two presentations, but both of them talk about the relationship of inequality with educational opportunity, and just a good amount of data will show that the number of poor or rural students going into China's elite universities has continually declined year after year after year. The dropout rate of those from rural and less well-off incomes is also considerably higher. And there's been a major, income, inequality of opportunity in education in which the best connected and the best off go to the least expensive and the most elite universities in China, and I think it'd be worth pursuing it in another venue. The other point, and I think my colleague Xiang Zhou did give me such a great presentation, but I would say that the assumption in yours and in everyone else's presentation is that the Maoist period was a period of equality or comparative equality, and I think our data on this is very weak. If we do it by income, you could argue that. But the regional disparities in the Maoist period were as great, if not greater, than today. They were great in the Republican period. They were great in the Qing. Actually, they were a little less great in the Qing. And it isn't true that in the Maoist period that everyone was eating from the same big pot. Some people were eating from really good pots, and some people were not eating in any pot. You have a series of policies that basically immiserate the countryside to pay for industrialization and export. And so one thing that these surveys, you can't do, I don't know how you do it today, happily you don't have this, but the biggest difference in inequality in the Maoist period is who's alive and who's dead. And how you measure, in 30 to 50 million people in the Great Leap Forward, and this is a tough thing. So I think this is a an unexamined myth of equality in the Maoist period, which makes the subsequent inequality look perhaps greater than it is.
My question is for Xiang. You mentioned that going forward, the regime will get its legitimacy from meritocracy, and you know social mobility is strong. But I have, my sense is that those things really, social mobility really depends on economic growth. If you can't deliver growth, then you know mobility won't be as high. You know, people perceive that hard work pays, but you know, as usual, people take credit for their success. But if they fail, they may actually blame the government. They worked hard and it didn't pay, so it must be government's fault. So could you elaborate on that legitimacy issue and how it works in this slow growth environment?
So the panelist can now answer all or any of those questions.
All right, so the first question, with Sanjay's question about the, I wanted to answer the question. I think the key question, including mobility questions, as I mentioned the talk and as we talking this point in China as well, is that we don't understand the baseline. Like even as simple as the Gini coefficient, with such a controversial among you know different people, different data set, China has just started to emerge of you know somewhat independent data sources. And this is a time, I think, that's why my team is not rushing into writing papers to explain marginal effect of mobility. We do, but we are not rushing yet to write those papers about the trying to explain education effect, whatever the effect on Gini coefficient, because we thought we don't even understand we're not trying to understand, I think understand how is important, and this is our academia very much focused on, but yet we don't understand what it is, we don't understand the level. So I always argue that we have to get baseline right. So we spend lots of effort, my team is trying to understand baseline, and the writing, you know, basic information in China is problematic, at least to say. So that's to answer the question. The mobility issue, we do have intergeneration mobility at the education level. We don't think the income measure is accurate. So we do ask our respondent asked about their parents' education. That's you know easy to measure and also pretty accurate. And we do find that at least from that aspect, intergenerational mobility is quite good. It's declining over the last few years, but it is compared with other countries, we're still quite mobile in terms of that in China. So that's why I very much support Dr. Zhao's point that we are not going to have unrest. The regime from that respect is not going. Don't worry about it. Before I released my Gini coefficient, I went to Beijing, talked to the officials. They told me that Dr. Gan, you know, we support you because of female research, but if you release 0.61, the country will revolt. I mean, they will have revolution. That's not the case, I think. That's not what China is about. Then I think that's, and indeed that's, people are pretty happy with what's going on. Satisfaction very high in the other data set to just.
There's some good questions. I would say the inequality of opportunity question is an important one, and it's one that's very difficult to get at with survey data. The CHIP data also asks about education of parents, and one can track how the education of children relates to the education of parents. At work along those lines, we haven't done it with the most recent round, but with the past round of the survey shows that educational mobility was increasing until, say, the late 1990s, early 2000s. And then more recently, in the 2000s, it began to decline, especially in urban areas. And it also shows there's a there's a great deal of segmentation in terms of inequality of opportunity within rural areas, or as measured by education. Within rural areas, the opportunities have been increasing. Within urban areas, they increased and then sort of began to decline. But moving from the set of opportunities that face rural households into the set of opportunities that face urban households is extremely difficult. To get to the question of risks and looking to the future, I wanted to mention one other piece of information, a set of information we collected in the latest round of the CHIP survey. We asked households how economically comfortable they were. These were sort of subjective questions. And we asked households how much economic security they felt they had. And the overwhelming majority of households, 80-90%, felt economically comfortable. But the overwhelming majority of households, urban, rural, migrant, said they felt they did not have economic security. They did not feel that they had the economic resilience to weather a shock, an economic shock. So another aspect of risk here, it's not just a question of what are the income levels, but how much fluctuation, how much risk do households face, and do they have the resources to adjust when they encounter risk? So that's, I think, another point to remember.
Thank you for so many insightful questions, and I will respond each one by one. First is that about the price difference. I totally agree with Professor Sicular that in that the adjustment of price difference has played a smaller role over time because of a more increasingly integrated market and also the rise of online commerce. And more people buy stuff from Alibaba. And so in my own paper about income inequality in 2010-2012, we also adjusted price difference across regions and urban-rural divide, and we didn't find much difference in terms of Gini coefficient, perhaps less than 10%, less than 5%, at least in 2012 wave. And about social mobility, this is a fascinating question. And in sociological research, people make a sharp distinction between two types of social mobility. One is absolute mobility, and the other is relative mobility. By absolute mobility, we mean that in a period of rapid economic growth, a rising tide lifts all boats. People move out of agriculture, people move out of poverty. So most people are getting better over time, either intergenerationally or intergenerationally. So they don't complain. And by relative mobility, after we adjust for the intergenerational changes in occupational distribution, in income distribution, how much of the two generations correlate in their relative ranks or, intergenerational associations, rather we control for the marginal distributions. And what I show in the chart is the extent of relative mobility has indeed declined over cohorts, although China still exhibits higher degree of mobility than other countries. But on the other hand, what I didn't show is that absolute mobility also increased because of the rapid industrialization and rapid economic growth. But in the long term, we can imagine that both will decline,
right,
due to a slower pace of industrialization over time in the future. And also the relative mobility, we didn't see many signs of slowing down because of the increasingly difficulty for rural kids to get to elite colleges. And so this is definitely a question that worth pursuing over time using more recent data sets to look at cohorts born in the 80s, 90s. And
another point I want to
make is that
either
perceptually or in time series, we have very little evidence about people's perception of inequality and mobility and the actual degree of mobility. So maybe in some countries, people perceive a high degree of mobility, whereas the real situation is not that case. For instance, I think earlier research have compared the US and Europe, and people in the US consistently perceive a higher degree of mobility than in the Europe, where in reality, the two continents are basically the same in the actual degree of mobility. So this is also a question I think is worth pursuing in the future for China as well as other developing countries. in terms of answering whether decreasing mobility and increasing inequality will cause social unrest or not.